فرحان قفا بينو للهيلو لا حد سلحتو محيلة ضربو شوفارة الليلة احنا جايين من كل مكان لصورة زينة البلدان زورو ونرجع فرحان
بشوت مغيب ربوتاي وتبمي شنو فاشم This week is the parasha of Bilam, and this beautiful parasha, there is something that I was reading this morning and I did not understand. I did not understand when Bilam, he received some people, messengers from the king of Moab, Balak, asking him if he can come to Moab and to curse the Jews. And the king of Moab, his name was Balak. And this king, he had no problem with the Jews. The Jews had no intention to fight him. The Jews, they were sitting in the desert with no problem with Moab. And what I do not understand, why the king of Moab, Balak, his name is Balak, why he wanted Bilam to come to curse him. And he told him, I will pay you. I will give you honor. I will glorify you. I will give you all what you want. Just please do me a favor. Come, and because I know that you are a big man, and I know that you whatever you bless, it's blessed. When you curse somebody, your curse is doing, its effect. So please do me a favor, and I will pay you for this favor. I will pay you whatever you want. This is more or less the story of this week. And then Bilam, when he heard from the mouth of those people that the king of Moab, he sent him, those people to ask him to come, to invite him to come to Moab to curse the Jews, he told them, well, to curse the Jews, I don't know. I have to ask Hashem. I must ask Hashem. I mean, if you would ask me to curse another nation, I don't need to ask Hashem. I will come and I will curse them. But now we are talking about the Jews. You don't ask me something easy. I have to ask Hashem. Okay? So Hashem came to Bilam at the night. And he told him, Bilam, who's those people here? Who are they? So Bilam said, those people are the messenger from Balak. He sent them to me to ask me to come. He invited me to come to Moab to curse the Jews, those people, this nation that came out from Egypt, that's sitting in front of him, and he's worried, and he wants me to come to that together. I will curse them, and then he will fight them and finish with them. So Hashem said to Bilam, Bilam, you know that you cannot curse them because the Jews are blessed. Even if you want to bless them, they do not need your blessing. And you cannot curse them, because they come from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are under my protection. And the children are under my protection. So you cannot curse them. The story finished. I don't want to talk about the rest of the conversation. I want just to stop here. I stop here with a big question. I don't understand the chutzpah. How dare Bilam, he just, when Hashem told him, who's those people? He told him, those people, they came to see me, to ask me from Balak to come to Moab to curse the Jews. I mean, understand, how can he ask this from Hashem? How can he tell, how can we think a minute? Bilam knows that Hashem, he did a lot of miracles to the Jews. All those miracles that Hashem did to the Jews, only to give them the Torah, and then to let them go to Eretz Israel. I don't understand. Without the Torah, the world cannot stand. You understand? And the Jews, when they received the Torah, when Hashem proposed the Torah to the nations said no. They said that they don't want Torah. And Hashem, he proposed the Torah to the Jews, they accept. So the Jews become the chosen people through the Torah that Hashem gave them. So I don't understand. Bilam knows that the Torah protects them. He knows that. He knows that the Jews, they study Torah. And the Torah protects them. So how can he curse them? How he can have an imagination to curse them? How can he curse them? Second, how can he say that to Hashem? Bilam knows that Hashem chose the Jews. All the miracles that Hashem did to the Jews, only to have a nation. They're his people. He gives them the Torah. I mean, how can Bilam think to curse the Jews first? I don't understand Balak too. Balak, he saw, listen to this, huh? Balak, he saw the wars that the Jews did with Og and Sihon, two big nations, and they destroyed them. And they took all their lands. I mean, and Hashem was with them. And Moshe Rabbeinu was the one who killed Og, this man, the giant man. I mean, I don't understand how can a curse of a man can affect a nation? I don't understand. Balak thought, if Bilam come, if he curse the Jews, his curse will be effected. It will come true. But Balak knows that with the Jews there is Moshe. And Moshe Rabbeinu is not, he's a tzaddik. He's a holy man. And Balak knows that Bilam is a rasha. So how a rasha can fight a tzaddik? And Balak knows this Moshe Rabbeinu, all the miracles that he did in Egypt. I mean, I don't understand. I mean, it's like you tell me, it's like you ask a mosquito to fight a lion. I mean, you cannot imagine that. A mosquito fight a lion. Can you turn a fin, a mosquito, a small mosquito, who want to fight the lion with his feet, how? The lion just with a little, just a blow with his mouth, he will kill thousands of mosquitoes. How can Bilam can fight Moshe Rabbeinu and the Jews? This is the parasha that it's very, very important to understand it. So, first, we have two questions about this parasha. I do not understand how Bilam and Balak thought to curse the Jews or to fight them. First, they know that Hashem protects them. Hashimi did a lot of miracles to the Jews. And he's with them. So how can he fight them? How can he curse them? And how can Bilam can have a thought to tell Hashem, it's a big chutzpah. I mean, it must be crazy, Bilam, to say, Hashem, well, Hashem, Balak, he wants me to curse the Jews. How do you understand this? A lot of times I was thinking about this parasha. This parasha is very, 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 it's very difficult parasha. It's very difficult parasha. It's very, a very difficult parasha to understand. I don't understand. How can, it's like a small nation, they want to go to fight America. Nation with some weapons, they want to fight a big, 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 big nation like America or like China or like Russia. I mean, how? And I don't understand how, what happened to them? And I don't understand. Balak and Bilam, they know that up to now, the Jews they are protected by Hashem. And how did he thought for 1 minute that he can curse them? My friend, I would like to tell you this. When Abraham Avinu, when Hashem said to Abraham Avinu to take Yitzhak, to sacrifice him, he went with Eliezer and Ishmael, both of them. And then, when they arrived to the mountain of Moriah, from far away, Abraham Avinu saw the presence of Hashem. So, Abraham Avinu, he said to Yitzhak, "Do you see what I see?" So Yitzhak, he said to Abraham, his father, "Yes, Papa, I see the presence of Hashem there. I see the Shekhinah, I see something, yes. I see the presence of Hashem there." So Abraham asked Eliezer and his friend, "Do you see what I see?" Eliezer, he said, "No, I don't see." "And you?" "No, I don't see." So Abraham told them, "Shivu lachem po'im hamo. Stay here with the dog." I mean, I'm sorry to tell you this. Can you imagine if I tell to somebody, "Please wait for me here with the dog"? That means I compare him to the dog, to donkey. But imagine I am with somebody and we are, I just said to him, "Please wait, I'm gonna go home, and you and the donkey, wait for me here." It's not fair. You know who was Eliezer? Eliezer was a big tzaddik. Abraham Avinu compared Eliezer to the donkey. And he asked him, he told him, "Sit with the donkey, wait for me with the donkey." All the Torah that Abraham Avinu, he knew, he teach it to Eliezer. And Eliezer, he was the big Rosh Yeshiva. And Eliezer, he teach the Torah to everybody. He was a big rabbi, Eliezer. Don't forget, Abraham Avinu, when he went to fight some nations to liberate Lot, he went with Eliezer. They were both. They were two. And they were miracles, miracles. That means that Eliezer was a big tzaddik. Eliezer used to take sand and he threw it on the enemies of Abraham and they got killed. That was Eliezer. Eliezer was a big, big tzaddik. And we compare Eliezer and Abraham compare Eliezer to the donkey. She will have a poem, Amor. And the other one as well, Ishmael as well, was a big tzaddik. How can you compare him as well to the donkey? He did a big teshuvah. He was a. How do you understand this? Shivu lachim poem ha'amor. Then, and he said, okay, you sit with donkey, and me and Yitzhak, we go up there, then we come back to you. But for the moment, you stay here. How do you understand this? My friend, I would like to tell you something. A lot of times, we see people when they pray, we see them thinking. They don't focus on the tefillah. Sometimes people, they do a mitzvah, but they don't focus on the mitzvah. They do the mitzvah, that's it. They don't feel, the happiness by doing the mitzvah. Or they don't feel it at all. It's just because it's a mitzvah. It's like people who put tefillin. There is people that really, they feel when they put the tefillin. They feel when they go to the synagogue. They feel the tefillah, they feel the Shabbat. It's like Shabbat. Shabbat is a pleasure. Ask it, anag al Hashem Elokecha. Shabbat is not a day for food. It's not a day just to sleep and to eat. Shabbat, it's a day who belongs to Hashem. Shabbat hu bein nafash. Shabbat belongs to Hashem. Shabbat gives you strength. Shabbat gives you emuna. Shabbat gives you koah. Shabbat is not just a day, a holiday day, a day of rest. No. Shabbat is a day that you fill yourself with energy, with emuna. To think, to study Torah, to think about Hashem. It's like you have one day to think about Hashem. As the Bnei Shai explained, all week we have no time to study Torah because we have to work. All week we are busy. So Hashem give us one day that we're not busy. That's why we're not allowed to do nothing. A day that we have to consider that day only for you and Hashem. Like, stay with me. On Shabbat, it's like Hashem asks you, stay only with me. And unfortunately, people, they do Shabbat, but they don't feel it. My friend, I think this is a message. Listen to this. The message of Abraham Abinu, alav shalom, when he asked Eliezer and Ishmael, when he asked them, do you see what I see? Do you see the presence of Hashem up there, over there? And they said no. So Abraham Abinu told them, so shivu lachem po emam. Hamor, it's not a donkey. Hamor is humriyut. Humriyut, that means material. That means Abraham Abinu give them a message. The message is that because you are full of material, yes, you are tzaddikim, you study Torah, but you need to do a little bit more. You have to take out the material from you, but you're still connected to the material. And because you are connected to the material, you don't see what I see. And it's hard because it's hard. It is disconnected from material, so you can see what you don't see. I would like to tell you something. My grandfather, Rabbi Chaim Peter, somebody told me that his father told him that the last year of Rabbi Chaim Peter, before he died, he was blind. He was really blind. He had a heavy diabetes, and he was very ill. He was completely, he couldn't see. People had to take him from place to place. But it's incredible, he told me, that man, that he was sitting, and suddenly he said to the people, there is X behind me. Can you call him? And yeah, it was maybe 100 meters from him. So they told him, Rabbi, did you see him? Can you see him? He said, no, you know I'm blind, I can't see. But how do you know? He said, I know. That means that even that he was blind, he can see. That means he can see. My question is, how can he see? But he's blind. So he's a prophet. So listen to this. Do you know why the tzaddikim they see what people, other people don't see? You know why? When a tzaddik takes care of his eyes not to see what he should not see, so Hashem help him to see what nobody can see. But when people, they don't care about what they see, so even think that they can see, they don't see. How much you have to be careful with your eyes? The tzaddikim, especially in our generation. Last night somebody came to see me. He was crying. He told me, Rabbi David, I have a big tzara. I studied Torah. I put tefillin. I keep Shabbat. I do a lot of mitzvot. But I have a big tzara. I see things that I'm not allowed to see there. What can I do? I told him, I cannot help you. If you know that you're not allowed to see them, and you see them, I cannot help you. If you study Torah, and you know that the Torah forbidden you not to look at them, and you see them, so I can't help you. You have to fight with yourself. It's something that only you have to fight. It's only you. I cannot help you. Because it's, everything is in the hand of Hashem, but when it comes to Achamayim, how to fear Hashem, it depends only to you. So I cannot help you. My friend, as long as we are connected to the material, we cannot feel nothing. We cannot feel any spiritual. We cannot see nothing. That was the message of Abraham Avinu. The message of Abraham Avinu, because don't forget, Yitzhak, he was the symbol of the Avodah. Abraham Avinu was the symbol of the Chesed. Yitzhak is the symbol of the Avodah. And Yaakov, he is the symbol of Torah. So Esav, so Yitzhak Avinu was the symbol of the Avodah. So that was the message. Abraham asked him, Abraham, Yitzhak, you that you are the son of the Avodah, do you see what I see? He said, yes, I see. That means that Yitzhak Avinu, he would send as a message to feel Hashem when you pray, you have to be disconnected from the material. So that's why Abraham asked the others, do you see what we see? No, we don't see. Ah, so Shibolachim po, so sit with the donkey. But it did not mean the donkey, because hamor is a donkey, but the word hamor is material. Hamor is humriyut. The material, as long as you are connected still with the material, you cannot see what we see. You cannot feel Hashem at 100%. My friend, I would like to tell you this. You know, we asked two questions before about Bil'am. How Bil'am and Balak can curse the Jews? How? And how can Bil'am have the chutzpah, the azut panim, when Hashem asked him, what is the people came for? What do you want from you? Ah, yes, he wants me to go to curse the Jews. How can you talk like that to Hashem? You know you cannot curse the Jews. You know the Jews are protected. You know there is a Moshe Rabbeinu. How can you talk like that? The answer is, it's not the fault of Balak, and it's not the fault of Bil'am. If this situation come, that Balak wanted to curse the Jews, and Balak, he dare to ask Hashem to go to curse those Jews, because the Torah said, Vayishev Yisrael Bashitim. Because the Jews at that moment, they were sitting and they did not study the Torah. Yeah. When, unfortunately, this is the message, when, God forbid, the Torah protects, but when there is no Torah, so people can talk bad about the Jews. People can dare to think, to have a thought, to destroy them, to curse them. You understand? So now we understand, because the Torah mentioned, Vayishev Yisrael Bashitim. Shitim is from the word shtut. Shtut is shtut. It's like from the word mad. When somebody, you know, my friend, when somebody don't do nothing, he has depression. When somebody does nothing, he can lose his mind. When somebody does nothing, a man should work. A man should do something. But when Vayishev Yisrael, they sit. They were sitting, doing nothing. They did not study the Torah. According to this, I saw in the Kabbalah some book, they said that Shittim, there is their water. You understand? So the Jews, they were drinking, only they sit and drinking water from the Shittim. And that water was, it was not a holy water. They were enjoying the nice weather, the nice water. So when, unfortunately, they had no Torah to protect them because they were not studying Torah. So Balak, he has a thought to curse the Jews. Bilam, he said to Hashem, Balak said, he sent me people to go to him to curse the Jews. And look how much Hashem is good to us. Even that the Jews were sitting there with no Torah and Shittim, Hashem protects. He still remains to protect them. Yeah. And then what happened, it was that we have to learn from here a lot of Musar, a lot of good things. I would like to tell you something. There is a pasuk who said, it's a pasuk in the parsha of this week, who said, Matuvo alecha Yaakov, mishkinet lecha Israel. When Bil'am, when Hashem gives the permission to Bil'am to go, but not to curse the Jews, to go to Balak, and he told him, go with him, we go to him, and then I will tell you what to do there. So Bilam went, so Balak was very happy. Ah, thank you that you came to curse the Jews. So Balak told him, Bilam told to Balak, no, I did not come here to curse the Jews, because only with the permission of Hashem. If Hashem give me the permission to curse, I will curse. Can you imagine? Do you think that Hashem can give to Balak? I mean, tell me, do you think that Hashem can give to Bilam Balak permission to curse the Jews? Tell me, it's impossible. So how can Balak and Bilam still thinking maybe they can still curse the Jews? How? Why Hashem let him go? Why Hashem did not say to Balak, to Bilam, no, you don't go, basta, finished. That's it. The answer is, and the Torah wants to teach you how much Hashem is good, how much Hashem is love, Am Israel, that even that if when they don't study Torah, still Hashem can protect them. Of course the Torah protect, but if they don't study Torah, still protect them. And why Hashem is saying to Balak, to Bilam, to go to Balak? Message for Zineb, for generation. That Hashem, that Hashem always is a protector, who will protect Am Israel, wherever they are. Even if they don't respect religion, even if they don't study Torah, even that there are nations that they think to do bad things to them, Hashem, he will remain to protect them. That's what we learn from this parasha. But just, I would like to tell you a beautiful story that, that is very important for you to listen. There was a man that, we heard this story here in Canada. There was a man who had a big problem with his company, and he lost a big amount of money. So this big amount of money, it was, he had some people that didn't pay him, and that was last year during the Hilula of Rabbi Chaim Pinto. And that man, he asked Madame Maggie Lebe, please, when you go to the Hilula to Isawera, please take all those papers, put them in the grave of Rabbi Chaim Pinto, and tell Rabbi David Pinto to pray for the Zichut Rabbi Chaim Pinto that I will have back my money. Otherwise, I'm lost, I'm bankrupt, I lose everything. And the Maggie Lebe, when she went to Morocco, she put all the papers on the cover of Rabbi Chaim Pinto, and she called him. She told him, Baruch Hashem, I am in Morocco, on the cover, he is Rabbi David Pinto here, and and we all pray that Hashem will help you not to do bankrupt, that you will have back your money. And everybody said Amen, and the story was finished. My friend, when Maggie Lebe, she came back to Canada, she gave back all the papers to that man. 6 months later, she saw him. She told him, so how are you? What happened to you last year? He said, well, I was waiting to call you, but by question that I lost the case. But my wife, she told me, it's impossible that you lost the case. We have Emuna, that with the Zichut of Rabbi Chaim Pinto, you will have back your money. But the husband said to his wife, but we lost the case. That's it. No, it's impossible. So Magish asked him, so what happened there? So he said, well, Baruch Hashem, 2-3 weeks later, I did an appeal and I won back a final victory and I had back my money. And she told him, did you give the ma'aser of that money? He said, I give the ma'aser, yes, to all the people, to some institutions, and I did not forget Rabbi David Pinto. I keep something for him as well. This is, Rabotai, how Hashem protects Am Israel. Yes. This is, Rabotai, my friend, that was the message of Hashem to all Jews. That Hashem protects. When the Bnei Israel, they follow Torah mitzvot, so unfortunately, a lot of enemies can be against them. But even those enemies that they are against them, still HaKadosh Baruch Hu will protect Am Israel. Still will protect them. There was a man, a big tzaddik, that didn't with sons. Somebody asked him, where was Hashem in the Shoah? You know, the Admon Mitzvot, Alav Shalom, Rabbi Yehuda, he could Rabbi Yehuda écoutait him, Halbesh Tamitzatz. They killed his wife and his 11 children. Normally, with the pain, he should die. But he was so strong. You know, he was among the people who, they were collecting bones, and they were collecting, you know, all the bodies that a Nazi used to kill. And then, Baruch Hashem, he escaped, and he got married again, and he had few children. And Baruch Hashem today is a big Hasidut, Tzatzk, Klesenberg Hasidut, there in Netanya, all over the world. But somebody asked him, hey, Rebbe, where was Hashem in the Shoah? You that you believe in Hashem, where was Hashem in the Shoah? He said, Hashem? He wasn't the Shoah with us. But was he in Auschwitz? He said, of course he was in Auschwitz. I was in Auschwitz. I escaped. I'm here. Even in Auschwitz, he was Hashem. Hashem was there. Yes. Baruch Hashem. He needed a new vision. Hitler wanted to kill the whole Jews. Baruch Hashem, we're all over. So this is the proof that Hashem exists. We did not have only one Hitler, only one Bilham, only one Haman. Every generation there is somebody. That's what we see in the Haggadah. שבחודו ועדו עומדים עלינו לחלוטנו והקדוש ברוך הוא מציל מן האדם. Every generation there is somebody who want to finish, want to find the solution against the Jews. And there is always a קדוש ברוך הוא. He is here to protect. But this is just a message that we should, all of us, we should keep. That at that time that the Jews were in the desert, and because they did not study Torah in that place called Shittim, Bilam and Balak got the permission that they can talk bad about the Jews and to curse them and to have bad thoughts about them. But when Jews keep Torah mitzvot, no one think about them, nothing. No one think about them. Not a small thought. So Rabotai, my friend, I wish you all the best, and God bless you, Beit Hashem. You should be always protected, and God will give you Baruch Hatzlach. Non douyen ezrartu